With how you handled the Larry Nassar case, did you do anything different because that case was so big? What I'm referring to is that you let, was it 156
sister survivors, 169 altogether. I always let everybody speak. The prosecutor, when the prosecutor and defense came to me, and I'd been planning for a trial. I have such a busy lifestyle. I don't always watch the Olympics. I knew some of the names. I didn't know they were coming in front of me initially or that they were even involved in the case. I don't look at those things. I don't get police reports. I didn't know Larry Nassar. He was in our community for years. I didn't know him. I'm not part of the gymnast community. I'm just a busy mom and judge and writer and all the things I do. And no clue about this case until it actually came to me. And the media calls, and I'm starting to read articles, and I had to put a gag order out there so that we could get a clean case and stop everybody talking. And the girls hated me because of that. But I needed to get a clean jury, and I was assured that there were experts on both sides. The attorneys came to me a few days before Thanksgiving and said, would you accept a plea? And I had already called in 200 jurors with special questions that they would have to ask. We had called up 800. We were doing them in batches of 200. And they told me what the plea agreement was. And that it really, you know, plea agreements, when you get into sexual assault, as a judge, I'm not happy with all of them. And some I don't accept. But I'm always thinking, what happens to the victim if they go to trial? Victims commit suicide. They're bulimic. They cut. There's all sorts of things that they do because they can't handle going to trial, publicly talking about what happened to them. It's a huge trigger. And I knew at that point that there were victims who were in their 30s and 40s, but also ones who were underage. And I know a lot about trauma. So I understood it was in everybody's best interest to accept the plea. So he pled to 7 counts out of 29, and he pled to 7 first degree criminal sexual conduct, which are life offenses. And then as part of the plea, they also did not issue on the additional child pornography they found on his phone. The people said, and although it's 7, we're going to have more testify. I said, everyone can testify. I've never put a limit on it. I'm not going to put a limit on it. And when they drafted their plea agreement, they put the limit of 125. That was their agreement. That wasn't my agreement. I have always let everybody speak because crime doesn't have a border. And the defense, of course, said, well, we don't want, there's doctors who want to talk. There's other people who want to talk. And I said, well, if you don't like it, appeal me. I don't care. Here's the thing. I want to step away from the Nassar case for just a minute and give you this example, because you really need to understand the Crime Victims' Rights Act talks about victims being allowed to speak, and they have other rights as well. But in that vein, let's just talk about speaking and victim. It doesn't say the person attacked. It says victim. I had a case of a home invasion where young couple of kids bought a house, very nice house in a nice part of our county. And then as a reward for unpacking, they went to Florida. The kids must have talked about it at school. And so people in the neighborhood and community knew they were going to Disney. They did not know, however, that the sister of the mom was going to be in the house while they were gone. They didn't want to leave the house alone. So there was a break-in. The burglars did not know the sister was going to be there. And so everybody was surprised. She was surprised. They were surprised. And they ended up duct taping her to the bed. Pillowcase over her head. She's taped. She got real still as they're breaking in, taking guns, medication, everything, jewelry, everything they could. And she got real still, but was working her way through the tape and did. And when the house was really quiet, she got out and she ran to her car and she dialed 911 on the way and she locked herself in the car. And just as she was pulling out of the driveway, they were going back in the house for more and they threw themselves on the windshield. It was just like a movie. And she backed out, they fell off. And because she had called 911, she heard sirens and she stopped the siren and she told them. And ultimately they were caught. What happened there? Who was the victim? She clearly was the victim. The sister was in the house, but the family learned about it. They came home. They couldn't sleep in the house. They bought dogs. They bought a burglar alarm. They didn't feel safe. And the sister only came over during the day and for short periods of time. They were all traumatized. They were all victims, not just the sister. They ultimately sold the house and moved away. That's how traumatized they were. You see, crime doesn't have a border. And so when I read the word victim in the Crime Victims' Rights Act, I look at it as this rippling effect. So yes, you saw 169 people testify in front of me. I would have sat there for 2,000. It doesn't matter. If the crime touches you, I believe you have a right, because it's your courtroom. It is not my courtroom. I believe it's your courtroom. You have the right to your day in court and to tell me how you felt and what happened. More importantly, the defendant gets to hear the effect of what their crime did to the victim. And ultimately, there is, and I've watched it, there's healing on both sides when that happens. I've seen it happen in my courtroom. You saw it happen in the Nassar case, I hope. I think that's what you saw. That's what I saw. But I see it in countless cases.
That you had parents of the girls who were sexually abused, that you also had Nassar's colleagues, some of them, because he groomed the environment. So
they were very upset. And, you know, I've always done this. So I know the power of the robe. I think giving voice to everybody is important. And, you know, there was a doctor who was absolutely heartbroken. If you watch his testimony, he basically says, how dare you? I trusted you with my patients who I love. I put them in your hands and you assaulted them. How dare you? Mm-hmm. And it was really important for that doctor to get that out. He's a victim.
Yeah. Yeah. Some of the doctors were talking about how they had referred people to Nassar. So they have that guilt as well. And then when some of the survivors were speaking forward, he would tell his colleagues that they have mental illness and in creating this whole story about these victims and stuff. And so making you not want to believe and stuff. It was really confusing for people and they trusted him, you know? So
I think I think the importance of, and if you've watched At the Heart of Gold, and if you ever all want to watch it as a class, I can get you some special permission to watch it. And we can have a conversation about it after, but the importance of At the Heart of Gold, and you can also watch it with Athlete A to really get the full picture. But I think At the Heart of Gold really goes to what you're talking about. It shows the grooming that went on, and grooming is a process of an adult who establishes an emotional connection with a child in order to abuse the child. It can be in person, it can be online. There's all sorts of ways to do it, but Nassar groomed all of those young girls. Trinae Gonzer, she thought of him as like, you know, this wonderful uncle kind of thing. He assaulted her since she was about 6 years old. And overall, he assaulted her, I think she estimates about 850 times. All right. And he groomed the police to believe, well, this is medical. There's nothing wrong with it. It's medical. Let me do a demonstration. He groomed his colleagues. He groomed the university. He groomed the parents. He groomed everybody to believe that he was the only guy that could get them to the Olympics. He was the only one who could help them, that they were special. He basically told each one of those girls how special they were. He gave them gifts. He slowly pushed the boundaries so that they all relied on him, so that they believed him. Because over the years, I mean, think about this. The saddest part of this whole case for me is that 30 years ago, if somebody would have listened to just one of the girls who complained, this case never would have been mine, and hundreds, maybe thousands would have been spared. And what he would do, and others around him, all right, because money and medals over the safety of children, that was the thinking. They gaslighted them. And gaslighting is a form of emotional abuse. It's a manipulating tactic used to gain power. It makes the victim question what they know to be true. So there were girls who said, I don't understand how this is helping me. What are you doing? And he would say, oh, the body's all connected. Or they would tell their coach, Kathy Klages, or whoever it was. And she would say, well, you know, we can complain about this, but then it'll affect the team. We might not make it to the Olympics, whatever would make the girl back down and not trust her own gut that said, man, someone putting their fingers in my vagina when my ankle is swollen doesn't make sense to me. And then what we also had is we see this pattern, because now we have the older athletes, when the younger ones would say, I don't like this, there's something wrong here. The older ones would say, oh, he does it to me all the time. It's perfectly fine. And so this continues and continues. And then there's so many people, and you can see it in this film, who say, well, how did the parents not know? Well, the parents were right in the room. And so that's one of the things that I talk about around the world, because this isn't the only case I've seen it in. You have to have the tough conversations. You have to use the right body parts. You need to understand informed consent. The parents would look, you know, they'd be across the room. The girl would be on the bed in these loose shorts, and he'd put a sheet over them, and there'd be towels, so it'd be blocking the parents' view, and he would do his thing. Now, the girl is looking and going, Jesus hurts, you know, kind of thing. And the parent has a real encouraging face, as we all do when our kids are getting a shot or what have you. Yeah, it'll be fine. It'll be fine. You're almost done. You're almost done. And so there's this miscommunication about what's happening. The parent thinks there's actual treatment going on. The child thinks that these ungloved fingers without Vaseline or any lubricant at all. The child is saying, well, what's going on here? And the parent doesn't know, can't see. So it's a huge misstep, a huge miscommunication. But he groomed everybody to believe that was right, and he was the one to do it.
Mm-hmm. He'd even have pictures of the Olympians on their wall, on the wall and stuff like that for them to see. And even when some of the survivors came forward, there were survivors that were in complete shock. Even Trinity Gonzer, she was like defending him. And when she talks about that, about defending him and how it was so hard for her to believe. And that's all part of that grooming and stuff, because a lot of times you do build that relationship that you are. Trinity, that was her friend, you know, she really liked it. And just watching her testimony was just gut-wrenching, you know, it was just.
Yeah, Trine, ultimately, it was gut-wrenching. She ultimately, her words were to the effect of, my friend, what have you done? It was almost biblical. She didn't even blame and shame him. She just wanted answers, because she truly loved him. And when she realized what had happened, she was completely betrayed.